start in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go!
Look at that. Bang on time. On time. 10 o'clock. Pow.
That is so strange, yes. Isn't it? We're on time. We've achieved it once. Once in a year. Yay. Look at us rocking. We've worked out how it works at last.
I know. So really excited today for the show, as well as all the local bits we've got. We've also got Andy Edmeads on from Camberley Theatre.
Yay.
That's correct, Mike. Well done. Yes.
I've been excited. And it's also been an exciting week because we've gone from snow last week to sunshine this week. And I discovered on Monday the downside of this great sunshine is I forgot I had so little hair and my head still hurts.
You were threatening about wearing shorts. Have you actually done that yet?
Not yet. The temperatures are dropping so much in the evenings. You know, I'm in the house now and I've got my my fleece on because it's cold, whereas outside is lovely and warm. So I'm going to go and stand in the garden and just warm
Mike,
up.
Mike, you're an adult. You can put the heating on.
No. It's called an extra jumper.
Oh, okay.
I'm not telling your wife you put the heating on when she's out.
I don't do that whatsoever. No. So we've got a lot happening on today's show in the next half an hour. So I'm going to say hello to Andy. Hello, Andy.
Hello. Nice to see you both.
Hi, Andy. Great to see you.
Likewise. So, how are you?
Very, very. We were just talking about how wonderful the sun is and the warmth again. It's great.
Yeah, it's not great for ginger-haired people like me. You have to be quite careful when you're in the sun, even in April. But it is lovely.
I was just saying that, you know, I don't have ginger hair, but I lack hair. And I forgot about that. I'm still suffering the consequences. It's still a bit sore on my head.
I love the way Andy's gelled his hair and everything. He's like, he's made a real effort.
I'm actually getting my first post-lockdown haircut tomorrow. So this is the last time it'll be seen like this. So enjoy this.
Okay. Are you going for the ultimate cut then? Are you sort of, I mean, I had mine done last week. So it was like grade two, grade three on top. You know, just cut it all off. I've had enough of it.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to having it trimmed, I have to say. It's been quite a few months.
But Andy's got more class than you, Neil. He'll be going to a stylist, whereas you just went to a gardener.
Actually, no, I didn't. We have a woman come round. We have a woman. Okay. We get a hairdresser in the house because there's so many of us. Yeah. Yeah, we just get a woman in the house. It's a lot easier. So,
a hairdresser here, because that sounds a bit better than a woman in the house.
Oh, sorry, a hairdresser. Yeah, okay. So, Andy, let's talk about Camberley Theatre.
Yeah, that's what we'd like to know.
And it's great, Andy, that we got you on today, because in the post, it's first time the post has arrived for a while, but I got my Camberley Theatre, I'll look at the camera, Camberley Theatre Summer brochure through about half an hour ago. It's great.
Amazing.
It's so exciting what's coming on. So go on, Neil. You know what you want to ask.
Obviously, Camberley Theatre is going to be starting, coming back in May. You've got a lot going on. I've noticed, as probably a lot of other people, that you've redone the front. You've got nice little signs up there and stickers on the windows. You've got one for the pantomime as well. Mm-hmm. So yep. I take it the pantomime's coming back.
Yes, definitely. So yeah, we started work on it last year. This would have been the show we would have done in 2020. So we're sort of picking that back up again and sort of continuing that work because it kind of came to a halt this time last year. Really, we knew probably it wasn't going to happen for us in the normal way. So yeah, very exciting to be getting back to doing what we do best, really, and looking forward to putting on a really good show this Christmas.
Yeah, it'll be fantastic because I know the pantomime is a main thing to do with Camberley Theatre, isn't it? You know, you write it, you produce it, you choreograph it. If I remember rightly, one of the cast members is like the director. Yeah, so yep. It's very much all in house, isn't it?
Being a former comedian, Andy, do you feature in it as well?
No, not if I can help it. There was an unfortunate incident at the end of Robin Hood when our dame went off sick. We think maybe with hindsight, coronavirus, but so long story short, one of our dancers went on as the dame, and one of the dancers' roles was to do the voice of the tree. And I went on as the voice of the tree. So I stood, I stood inside the tree carcass on stage, and I became a talking tree from Essex. That's the closest I've come in my 6 years at Camberley to being on stage there.
I can imagine, though, that on your CV, you know, talking tree from Essex.
Talking tree from Essex, yeah.
I don't know where that credit will take me next, but hopefully someday.
It's almost like third dancer from the right in Strictly, isn't it? You know, yeah, that sort of thing, really.
I think third dancer on the right is slightly better than talking tree stage right.
Yeah. So, okay, let's talk about Canby Theatre. Let's talk about what's going on. So you've got you come back in May. I take it it's going to be limited to numbers actually in the auditorium, isn't it?
Our capacity is about 150. So normally it's 400, so we're well under half still. But we've got a really good mix of stuff. So we've got some amazing stand-up comedians. We've got some live music, some family shows as well in half term. So it kind of feels like a normal sort of season of shows, just with slightly less people. So we've tried not to sort of change the quality or the sort of the variety of what we normally have. And actually that experience for those lucky 150 that do get to come and see it will be really great. Yeah, you know, all the usual social distancing measures, all the things that we've come used to having for now, you know, wearing masks, hand sanitizers, one-way systems, perspex screens, they're still there for the time being. But it would just be so lovely to get back and seeing shows again and putting shows on for audiences.
I was just going to say, I've just spotted one on the weekend of the 22nd, 23rd of May.
Are you actually reading? You're actually going through the
I'm looking at the thing as I'm sat here. 2020, the COVID musical.
Yeah. So yes. It's a new musical written by a dancer called Natasha Mould, who has worked with Strictly and other sort of shows like that, and the cast are all West End performers, and the premise of the show is kind of what happened to that industry and that group of people when their work is just completely obliterated. And out of it, you know, comes the stories of how they've had to adapt and change, and I think maybe you see a bit more of the less glamorous side perhaps of performing arts, which maybe people don't quite realize. So it's been a really difficult year for everybody, but I think particularly that sector where it's been grim consistently for a year.
The thing is, the entertainment side has not qualified at all for the government grant, has it, really? I'm being a plumber, I qualified. Mike obviously hasn't been, you know, because he's been working all the way through it. But yeah. The thing is, there are people out there who just didn't qualify, and the theatre was one of those things, you know, which is just absolutely ridiculous.
Venues got support eventually, didn't they? There was a big government grant there, but I think a lot of sort of self-employed performers were the ones that suffered. So I think that the 2020 musical is kind of their story, really, how they adapted and how they've had to deal with it and try and create something positive out of a really tough year.
And I think that's I had a conversation. I do St John Ambulance and was interviewing people to be volunteer vaccinators a few months ago, and had an interview with a semi-famous actor who, that's as far as I'm going to take who it is. But we had more of the conversation was about how they'd coped in the lockdown and how they'd managed to establish. And that person said to me, so I'm not even giving the gender away, that person said to me that they were having to help at a friend's coffee shop until that dried up and wait on tables. And they said that was really, you know, a shock to the system from being somebody that's used to doing back-to-back work. And it's been hard. And there's been a real campaign, haven't there, with Judi Dench. Dame Judi Dench has fronted some of it. I'm trying to remember the T-shirts, but I've seen it several times on social media.
I think you mean the shows will go on.
The show will go on campaign. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And it's, you know, it's a real shock. You know, I absolutely love musicals. And one of the best things I saw at Camberley Theatre was the Beyond the Barricades.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
a couple of years ago, which was, we did have an amusing part in the midst of the second half where two people decided to start arguing, and It was handled very well.
Okay. I'm glad to hear it.
It was one of those where you go, is this part of the show? No, it's not. And then the guy on stage said, we'll just pause here and just let that sort itself out. And then he carried on. But I do miss going into a theatre and doing things.
That's the beauty of live entertainment, isn't it? You never know what's going to happen next. And most of the time it goes swimmingly without any hiccups. Other times you get problems. Absolutely. But that is the beauty of it, isn't it? That's why you can't replicate. TV and film is great, but you can't replace that live experience.
It is amazing.
I'm going to have to let you talk. Somebody's just knocked at the door.
Okay. I mean, obviously, I work with kids in the theatre, and it's quite amazing. They will skip like a whole scene, and then the poor lighting bloke is trying to, where are we? I mean, you must get that in your, you know, in your film. Not so much, obviously, with the panto, but with other things where you get given all the plots and everything for the lighting and the sound cues, and then all of a sudden someone skips something, and you're like, where are we? Where are you?
And I think people don't often realise how meticulously a show is planned. You know, it is about hitting that mark on for your lighting cue or saying that right line so that the sound can start. You know, it's almost quite scientific, really. Once you've plotted the show and you've rehearsed it and you've got it ready, actually you've got to hit those marks so that everything else can work so it looks right on stage. That it doesn't happen by accident. It's very well planned.
It is, and stage direction and stage management is an art in itself. So it's just something which is actually fantastic. We've got a message here from Jason. Jason's one of our watchers. He wants as a music. I don't understand, right? Jason has done absolutely everything. No matter what we do, he always says, "Oh, I've done that." So he wants to know about big bands. Is that something that you think that you could? In the future, have you had any big bands? I know you've had like Glenn Miller and people like that. Well, the Glenn Miller band.
Yeah, we've had orchestras. We've had, we have got Ronnie Scott's jazz band coming back next year. There's absolutely no reason why we haven't had them. I guess the quick answer is you don't get many of them on the touring circuit. And we're a receiving house. The only show we produce is panto. So we kind of book shows depending on what's given to us or what's around and what comes our way. But if Jason wants to get in touch, he's got contacts with local military bands, I'm definitely happy to have a chat about that one.
Yeah, cool. Excellent. So, let's talk about Squish. Okay. Now Squish is your new project, isn't it? For Camberley Theatre. And it's, whereabouts is it located? Is it, in Camberley, isn't it?
Yeah. So we're in the Square Shopping Centre, opposite Sainsbury's in what was Top Shop and Top Man. Okay. Downstairs on the bottom floor is, as you've seen from the pictures there, it's got a soft play. We'll have a box office, cafe, a story corner, and an activity sort of craft area. And then upstairs, which was Top Man, will be our performance space. So it'll be a sort of 55-seater, I'd say a black box. It's a bit more interactive than that, but kind of a studio space where every Saturday in May, June and July, we'll have a kids show at 11 o'clock and 2 o'clock. It's gonna be really exciting. That I mean, those pictures, that was all done in a week, so the team have been working really hard to transform that space.
So let's just talk about the pictures quickly. So we have, this is like a soft play area. What's your thoughts behind this?
So really the whole point of Squish is it's the children's space. So when they want to come and see a show, play on the soft play, read a book with mum and dad, do some colouring or some craft. It's something for everybody. For the sort of tagline we're working to, it's a big space to dream big and big imaginations for little people. So it's everything is very child focused and child friendly. It's a place really to come in and explore and create really and have fun.
Is it like a free space, or are you charging for it? How does that work?
So it's a mix of both. Some of the things are free. It's free to come into. It's free to grab a book, free to go on the soft play. There's activities and workshops which are anything from £1 to £6 to do, and then there's ticketed shows at the weekend. So again, there is something sort of for all budgets and for all interests. I hope that's certainly the plan, is to sort of have a space where kids will want to come and parents will want to go with their kids and feel like there's something for them to keep them occupied. And it's just nice to have something really different and fun to look forward to in town. I think after the year we've we've all had. Mm. It's just nice to have something positive to work on and something different.
It's fantastic, and it's nice and bright and vibrant. You've had your team in there working because they haven't really got a lot to do at the theatre at the moment, so they've been there painting and making sets and things like that. So and also this is going to be oh, Mike's back. Hang on, let's just bring him in. Here we go. you're on mute.
Sorry about that.
So also the other thing is you're bringing a ticket office, aren't you, to this thing as well?
So yeah, there'll be a box office, there'll be a cafe in there as well. So it's kind of, the idea is the pop-up venue. So until the 31st of July, it will be there. It's completely self-contained. Just a really sort of fun space for families to enjoy.
And it's just until the end of July. Is it not going to go beyond that, do you think?
Don't know. At the moment, the plan is we open on the 18th of May to the 31st of July. That's what we're doing. The fun of it for now is that it's pop-up. You've got to get a ticket quick because there's limited numbers. So it's kind of to see really what the interest is in something in the middle of town. But, who knows? It's been fun so far. So watch this space, I guess.
It sounds excellent. We'll have to get you some welcome back and tea postcards.
That
would be lovely.
Yeah. Well, I'll drop some postcards in there. So it'll be, I'm going around town tomorrow. So so with Squish and obviously with Camberley Theatre, what's happening, because you do, you're quite a busy boy, really, but you do summer events as well, don't you? Are you still carrying on like you did, you started off doing the teepee event last year. Is that something you're looking to do again?
Yeah. So that's not happening this year. That was the comedy festival that you mentioned. It's not happening this year, but it's very much something we'd like to do in future. We are hoping to do a Theatre in the Park series this in August, which will be probably 4 or 5 days of shows. Historically, we've done it either in London Road Rec or Frimley Lodge Park.
Yeah.
But we're looking at potentially taking it a little bit around the borough and doing it. That's the good thing with COVID. It's kind of made a lot of theatre companies be quite a lot more adaptable and sort of think outside the box. So we've got shows, for example, that are completely self-contained. They tour in a transit van and that opens up and that's their stage. So that that actually can go anywhere. It doesn't need to be fixed to a certain place. So it has sort of created a bit more opportunity for us to get out and about a bit more rather than being wedged firmly to one location. So yeah, hopefully soon we'll have some stuff to share with that, but that will be in August.
And the question somebody's just asked is that for all ages? Would it be something appropriate for families as well as?
So for the Emma, if your question's about Squish, yes, for all ages from sort of 0 to 10, 11. And for the Theatre in the Park stuff, we've got shows for kids, families, and also then shows in the evening for adults as well. So something for everyone.
It'd be great to see some of those come on, you know, rather than just in the park, on some of the high streets, you know, like Park Street or on Frimley High Street or the centre of Bagshot or something like that, you know, just in different locations around, you know, take it out to the villages.
Sorry,
Heath show, you've had like things like that. You've had 1 year you had, I think it was out the back of a truck. Basically it was like a non-stop quick change musical.
The jukeboxes.
You know, well, literally you said that they turned up in their transit van with their trailer on the back and that was it. So it's really easy for these events to actually happen if you have obviously the space and they can actually get in to do it. So it's something you just book them, they come and do it. And then, so it's live theatre is actually fantastic. Obviously, Edinburgh have their Fringe Festival and things like that. It would be great for Camberley to have something like that. There we go. Camberley Fringe Festival. Okay?
I'll take that one.
Yeah. So let's move on a bit. We've talked about the theatre and we've talked about Squish. Let's talk about, obviously, it's Queen Elizabeth's birthday today. I'm going to throw a question at you guys. Tea. Okay? Are you tea drinkers?
Of course.
Absolutely. Yep.
Right. Now, do you put the milk in first or do you put the tea in first?
Go on, Andy, you go first.
So for me, this depends on whether it's a tea bag and a kettle or a pot. If it's a tea bag and kettle, then I'd do water and then tea. Water and then milk. Yeah. Otherwise, I would do milk in the cup first if I was using a pot and then pour the pot on top.
And what about you, Mike?
I think I'd go with Andy on this, because certainly, you know, if you're brewing it straight in the cup, you put the, you wouldn't want to put milk, hot water on milk in a tea bag. It'd just be weird. So you'd put the tea, do the tea first, wouldn't you? Then put the milk on. But if it's
started a riot, I've just seen Lisa mess you. Tea in first.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you're doing it in a pot, you know, you put the milk in first in your cup and then the tea on top. But you've got to let it, the trick is letting it stew for a long time. We don't brew our tea for long enough. That's the issue.
The trouble is my wife, okay, she loves strong tea. So you put the tea bag in. I then make myself a coffee and then add a little dribble of milk.
Can I make a Lancastrian statement here?
Go on then.
Coming from Lancashire, please tell me you don't have Yorkshire tea.
Well, I'm not saying anything.
The only time you will ever see me, you know, bow down to Yorkshire superiority, it is pretty good tea.
It is. It is. And what's your tea preference? Do you just have whatever's going, Andy?
No, there's certain bags that I wouldn't like to have. I don't want to chuck any brands under the bus, but my favourite would be, at choice, would be an English breakfast.
Oh, yeah, that's very nice.
English breakfast tea. Of course, Jason has to comment. He uses the leaf tea.
A pot and a strain. Only Jason. Only Jason. I must admit, my favourite, I do like Earl Grey. I really do like a cup of Earl Grey. And it used to taste so, when I lived in Germany, it was lovely because they'd always do tea in a glass cup. And it tasted so much purer than China for some reason. It was really
nice. You know what? Back in the 70s, When I used to go to my nan's, we used to go to...
Can I just pause there a second? Because me and Andy have no idea what the 70s is.
That's what I'm just saying. Back in the 70s. Okay. We used to go to a place that was called the Golden Egg. And basically you had a glass teacup and a glass saucer. I don't know why it was glass, but they always used to have tea and coffee in glass. It must have been something for the 70s. I don't know. But yeah, I know what you're saying, Mike. Earl Grey in a glass, and also the tea diffusers you can get now, which are made out of glass, and you can actually see the tea.
Can I just say you're getting a bit posh here?
Sorry. moving on.
That's gone over our heads as well. You know, tea in a mug with, you know, in the army, I was just grateful that I got something hot and wet. I wasn't convinced it was tea half the time. And the worst thing I ever had was a green chai latte. All I can say is don't ever be tempted by it. That's the look, Andy. Did you know? And it was a chef that gave it me who swore blind that it was absolutely delicious. You know, it's really nice, Padre. You've got to try it. Yeah, no. I don't understand green tea anyway because it tastes like grass clippings. But
yeah, see, Emma has Yorkshire tea bags as well.
Yeah.
My in-laws have Yorkshire tea bags and for hard water. I didn't realise you could get tea bags for hard water.
But having family in Northern Ireland, I have to confess, Thompson's tea from Northern Ireland is actually better than Yorkshire tea, so sorry.
You're just saying that. You know he's watching, that's why.
Yeah, I'm hoping to
Yorkshire tea now do bags that sort of flavoured bags, so you can get Yorkshire tea that tastes a bit like biscuits or jam or toast and stuff like that, yeah. The biscuits are quite nice.
Why would you have like flavored tea? Like,
personally, I would just put a biscuit in my tea. Just dunk the biscuit. That does the job, doesn't it? But
I was about to say, like, take the pleasure out of dunking. And
we started something now. Let's not get onto dunking biscuits.
I feel like this is a separate podcast.
Absolutely, this is a separate thing. We're going down a rabbit hole again.
Again, yeah.
But what's the next question you've got then, Neil?
Yeah, the main question I wanted to ask today is: in the car, what do you listen to? What do you listen to in the car? Are you a podcasting person, or do you listen to your tunes, your jams while you're in the car? You know, I can imagine Mike listening away to the Beach Boys, zooming away. He's got the window down. He's got sunglasses on. Yeah, wishing he was in California. No,
that's taking it one step too far.
Oh, sorry.
It depends what mood you're in, doesn't it? Really. So I quite like a mix. So. I listen to the radio. I don't really have a CD on. I tend to listen to the radio most of the time. And depending on who's on, quite like Sarah Cox on Radio 2, that's really good. But sometimes I just like having Classic FM on and listening to the classic stuff, you know, chilled out stuff. It just depends on the mood. And other times, you know, if it's a long journey, Radio 4 or, you know, an audio book, you can't beat it.
I mean, what do your kids do when you get in the car? Do your kids take over the stereo? Do they like when my daughter gets in the car straight away? It's like, you know, she gets my phone. It's like, right, we're going to have this on. At the moment, she's listening to Beetlejuice. So we have
Beetlejuice.
It's a stage show. It's a stage show. Beetlejuice.
Oh, okay.
So we have that. So what do you listen to, Andy, in the car?
So my go-to is either a Spotify playlist I've created, which is, it's got about 2,500 songs in it. And it's just basically, the rule is anything that I like. Could be an album track, could be a remix, could be a really nass pop song, but it goes in that playlist. So it's the real mix. It's that embarrassing mix of when someone else in the car with you, you're like, oh, what's going to happen? What's going to come on next? It's all stuff I like, but it doesn't necessarily mean other people are going to appreciate it.
But this is when you've got the traffic lights and you've got the window down.
Yeah, you've got the window down.
You're whizzing away and the person next to you looks at you and goes,
I don't have ching 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 ching.
It's more ballady.
Really?
The other thing I'm listening to is I'm listening to the Line of Duty podcast at the moment, which is brilliant. So I do quite enjoy a podcast from time to time. It's nice to sort of feel like you're having a bit of a debate when you're hearing sort of voices in the car. So yeah, but generally music.
Can I just check you're hearing voices in the car when you've got a podcast on?
only when I'm driving with the podcast
on. Okay, that's fine.
I must admit, when I used to do a lot of driving when I was a rep out on the road, and used to go for music. I even used to listen to Radio 4. I started listening to The Archers at some point because you're just in the car so long that you just want things to listen to. So music sort of tends to go literally out the window, especially in the summer. So
well, this year's been odd, though, hasn't it? Because our road mileage has reduced so much. You know, I'm looking, they reckon car insurance will come down this year. As long as you swap, you know, if you stay with your insurance provider, it always go up. But they reckon if you swap on average, it's coming down 50 quid. Just because we've reduced our mileage and the risk has gone down, but that prevents you listening to as much in the car. So, you know, I've got a CD, old fashioned me, in the car that I've not got to the end of yet. And it's been in there over a year because I've just not been out in the car that much at all.
I used to really enjoy sticking a CD on in the car and having that time to listen to it in its entirety. Whereas I find with Spotify playlist, it's random songs. And if after a minute I'm not feeling it, I skip it. I couldn't tell you what a whole album sounds like sometimes. Whereas with a CD in the car, I used to sort of dedicate my time to listening to it.
I didn't even know what's next.
I was just going to say, one of my favourites was driving back from Germany, because you knew it was, when we lived there, it was a 7-hour journey, and it was great. And I used to always put on the War of the Worlds CD and listen to it. The original. Absolutely brilliant. Absolutely brilliant.
I can remember driving back from Exeter University, where I was a student at the time, and I'm a big Amy Winehouse fan, and there'd been a big block of years between Frank and Back to Black, and the student radio station at the time got a pre-release copy of Back to Black, and so I thought I'll borrow that for the weekend, listen to it in the car while I go home for the weekend. But the album's really short; it's like 38 minutes long. So a three and a half hour journey home, I just but that album still to this day is one of my favourite albums, because I think I listened to it about eight times over and over again.
But it's amazing how music takes you back to certain occasions, isn't it, and events, and it.
I am a great fan of the 80s. Some people will say that there wasn't a lot of good music in the 80s, but actually there was. There were so many different genres in the 80s. Yeah. It was like you had the doo-wop stuff at the beginning of the 80s, then you went into like erasure, and then you started to go into house music and things like that. So in those 10 years, so much happened in the music industry. But another conversation we could go
another
on.
Tangent, another tangent. It happens all the time.
It's coming up, but we need to start wrapping things up. But I've just got one more question for you, Andy. Okay, if the theatre could take any show. Now I know there are some restrictions with Camberley Theatre because of the way it's built. But if the theatre could take any show, what is the one show you would love to put into it?
Wow. I'm a big fan of plays, so plays would always be my thing to go and see. So I would probably say A Streetcar Named Desire by Tennessee Williams. I love that play, and I saw it when I was about 17 at the National with Glenn Close, and they had this incredible revolving set that that had their flat, the neighbor's flat. It was brilliant. One part was the bar they used to go to. So I would say Streetcar would be my ultimate. It can't possibly fit into our stage, but if it could, that would be the play I would put on.
That would be amazing, actually, wouldn't it? Something like that.
Yeah, It would be. So all those drama groups out there go, right, Streetcar Named Desire.
Put this on and Andy will let us have the space.
Yeah. challenge set.
Andy, he sat at the back making notes going, no, they're no good, right? Okay.
It wasn't like that when I saw Glenn Close in it. Yeah.
We need a tree from Essex. That would make it better.
I'd like to say a massive thank you, Andy, for coming and joining us today. Thank you, Mike, as always, for being...
No problem. And my... see everyone next week. Thanks, Andy. Look forward to seeing you next time you're in a cafe for a bacon butty.
Definitely. Sounds good. Take care.
Okay. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye.